The Teachings of Sylvanus from the Nag Hammadi Library at Gnosis.org, along with Reader's Note. This is part two. If you haven't seen part one, it's linked right now up in the top right-hand corner of the screen, as well as in the description box below. Listen, my son, to my advice. Do not be arrogant in opposition to every good opinion, but take for yourself the side of divinity, of reason. Keep the holy commandments of Jesus Christ. You will then reign over every place on the earth and will be honored by the angels and the archangels. You will then acquire them as friends and as of fellow servants. You will acquire places in heaven above. I'd like to stop and make a reader's note. It says that we are to follow the commandments of Jesus Christ, and then we can reign over all the places on earth and acquire angels and archangels as servants and friends. Jesus is to pour or to measure out, and Christ is reason or logical thinking, i.e. the Logos. So Jesus Christ has only given two commandments, and that's listed in the book of Mark. And it says, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind and strength. And this is the first commandment. And the second is like the first, namely this, you shall love your neighbor like yourself. So the two commandments that Jesus is giving out is for us to love the divine mind, the divine law and consciousness that resides within you and me and all others. Love yourself, love that divinity in you. And the same exact thing is love the neighbors and all others, because they also have that divine residing in them as well. Reign over all the places on earth. That means that you'll be in control. You'll be in control and rule over those fleshly thoughts and words, actions and deeds. And if you do these things, you shall acquire angels and archangels as your friends and your servants. Now, this gets quite complicated, but I'll just say that angels can be considered angles, and angles are perceptions, perspectives, and understandings. So if we do all of these things, these commandments, and we rule over our fleshly thoughts, words, actions, and deeds, then we can acquire a new perception, understanding, perspective, and timing of external, planetary, and evolutionary cyclical energies, as well as their positive and negative, or their male and female aspects. Do not bring grief and trouble to the divine which is within you, but when you will care for it, it will request of you that you remain pure and will become self-controlled in your soul and your body, and you will become a throne of wisdom and one belonging to God's household. He will then give you a great light through it, through that wisdom. But before everything else, know your birth. Know yourself, that is, from what substance you are, or from what race, or from what species. Understand that you have come into being from three races, from the earth, from the formed, and from the created. The body has come into being from the earth with an earthly substance, but the formed, for the sake of the soul, has come into being from the thought of the divine. The created, however, is the mind, which has to come into being in conformity with the image of God. The divine mind has substance from the divine, but the soul is that which he, God, formed from their hearts. For I think that it, the soul, exists as a wife of that which has come into being in conformity with the image, but matter is the substance of the body, which has come into being from the earth. If you mix yourself, you will acquire the three parts as you fall from virtue into inferiority. Live according to the mind. Do not think about things pertaining to the flesh. Acquire strength, for the mind is strong. If you fall from this other, you have become male-female. And if you cast out of yourself the substance of the mind, which is thought, you have cut off the male part and turned yourself to the female part alone. You have become psychic, since you have received the substance of the formed. And if you cast out the smallest part of this, so that you do not acquire again a human part, but you have accepted for yourself the animal thought and likeness, then you have become fleshly, since you have taken on an animal nature. For if it is difficult to find a psychical man, how much more then is it to find the Lord? But I say that God is the spiritual one. Man has taken shape from the substance of God. The divine soul shares partly in this one. Furthermore, it shares partly in the flesh. The base soul is wont to turn from side to side, missing text, in which it images the truth. Is it good for you, O man, to turn yourself toward the human rather than toward the animal nature? I mean toward the fleshly? You will take on the likeness of the part toward which you will turn yourself. I shall say something further to you. Again, for what will you be zealous? Did you wish to become an animal when you had come into this kind of nature? But rather share in a true nature of life. To be sure, animality will guide you into the race of the earth, but the rational nature will guide you into rational ways. Turn toward the rational nature, and cast from yourself the earth-begotten nature. O soul, persistent one, be sober and shake off your drunkenness, which is the work of ignorance. If you persist and live in the body, you dwell in rusticity. When you entered into a bodily birth, you were begotten. Come into being inside of the bridal chamber. Be illuminated in mind. My son, do not swim in any water, and do not allow yourself to be defiled by strange kinds of knowledge. Certainly you know that the schemes of the adversary are not few, and that the tricks which he has are varied. Especially has the noetic man been robbed of the intelligence of the snake. For it is fitting for you to be in agreement with the intelligence of these two, with the intelligence of the snake, and with the innocence of the dove, lest he, the adversary, come into you in the guise of a flatterer, as a true friend, saying, I advise good things for you. But you did not recognize the deceitfulness of this one when you received him as a true friend. For he casts into your heart evil thoughts as good ones, and hypocrisy in the guise of true wisdom, avidity or eagerness in the guise of conservative frugality, love of glory in the guise of that which is beautiful, and boastfulness and pride in the guise of great austerity, and godlessness as great godliness. For he who says, I have many gods, is godless, and he casts false knowledge into your heart in the guise of mysterious words and theories. Who will be able to comprehend his thoughts and his devices, which are varied, since he is a great mind for those who wish to accept him as their king? O my son, how will you be able to comprehend the schemes of this one, or his soul-killing counsel? For his devices and the schemes of his wickedness are many. And think about his entrances, that is, how he will enter into your soul, and in what garment he will enter you. Accept Christ, reason, who is able to set you free, and who has taken on the devices of that one, so that through these he might destroy him by deceit. But this is the King whom you have, who is forever invincible, against whom no one will be able to fight, nor say a word. This is your King and your Father, for there is no one like him. The divine teacher is with you always. He is a helper, and he meets you because of the good which is in you. Do not put maliciousness in your judgment, for every malicious man harms his own heart. For only a foolish man is wont to his destruction, but a wise man knows his way. And a foolish man does not guard against speaking a mystery. A wise man, however, does not blurt out every word, but he will be discriminating towards those who hear. Do not mention everything in presence of those whom you do not know. You may have a great number of friends, but not counselors. You should first examine your counselor teachers, for do not honor anyone who flatters you. Their word, to be sure, is sweet as honey, but their heart is full of hellebore. For whenever they think that they have become a reliable friend, then they will deceitfully turn against you, and they will cast you down in the mire. Do not trust anyone as a friend, for this whole world has come into being deceitfully, and every man is troubled in vain. All the things of the world or the flesh are not profitable, but they happen in vain. There is no one, not even a brother, who is trustworthy, since each one is seeking his own advantage. Oh, my son, try not to have anyone as a friend. But if you do acquire one, do not entrust yourself to him. Entrust yourself to God alone as Father and as friend. For everyone proceeds deceitfully, while the whole earth is full of suffering and pain, in the things which there are no profit. If you truly wish to pass your life in peace and in quiet, do not keep company with anyone at all. But if you do keep company with them, be as if you don't. So be pleasing to God, and then you will not need anyone. To be continued in part 3. Until then, always love yourselves and love each other unconditionally.